In this video, I'm going to discuss the AWS Solutions Architect job description, the Azure Solutions Architect job description, and the Cloud Architect job description. And this will also apply for GCP Solutions Architects. The reason I'm making this video is I have interviewed several thousand people for solutions architect roles, cloud architect roles, enterprise architect roles over the years. And so many times there's so much confusion about a solutions architect role or a cloud architect role that someone spends a lot of time and a lot of effort and they really try hard to prepare. But ultimately, they prepared for a different job description. They prepared for a cloud engineer's job description, not a cloud architect's job description or a solutions architect job description. So we're going to talk about what that description is. I'll briefly talk about the reason for the confusion about cloud architect and solution architect job descriptions, as part of it is the way they are written. And oftentimes in tech, a job description is written by either HR or by a hiring manager who cut and paste something from another website, and then they see there's nothing related to their job, and then they add that to the job description, and then they upload it as a new one. So by the time you're done, you've got a job description that people see that has nothing to do with the actual job. Also, sometimes employers have big, broad job descriptions because they're trying to capture people from a wide variety of backgrounds. And if you'd like to learn more about that, I interviewed the CEO, Christina Marino of ITXL in New York, a national recruiting firm, and you can see why she talks about these job descriptions being so broad. So the next reason there's a lot of confusion of what is a solutions architect is actually the name of the AWS Solutions Architect certification, or even the Azure Solutions Architect certification. In the AWS Solutions Architect certification, it covers systems administration and cloud administration, which is the how-to, not cloud architecture, which is more about the design and designing for business purposes. But it's a great certification nonetheless. It's just teaching things that are related to administration, not architecture. And of course, cloud architects and solution architects can benefit from learning those cloud provider-specific things, and we can, and it's good for us. But what's taught in the certification isn't necessarily the role. So what is the real AWS Solutions Architect job description, GCP Solutions Architect job description, Cloud Architect job description? So I'm going to give you some brief things, and then I'm going to talk about what we really do. The first thing I need you to know is this is not a hands-on role. You won't see a cloud architect working with Terraform. You won't see them working with Linux. You won't see them writing a Python script or interpreting a Python script or a Bash shell script or any of it. This is not a hands-on role. There is no coding, configuring, implementing, or anything like that in the cloud architect job description or the real solutions architect job description. We don't touch the tech, but we do so many things. And I'm going to talk to you now about what they are. So here's what we really do. And first, I'll talk about the difference between the solutions architect and the cloud architect, but the job description is pretty much the same thing. The cloud architect will design a multi-vendor and a multi-cloud solution. So think about it from the perspective of a real-world enterprise. The cloud architect will be working with potentially 1,000 vendors and 2 and 3 cloud providers. So because of that, in most cases outside of AWS, where the cloud architect is a different job description, the cloud architect is a little more bigger picture and a little less tech than the solutions architect, because the solutions architect, as a rule, predominantly designs, presents, and sells a solution on a single cloud and a single cloud provider as a vendor. So if you're the solutions architect and you're only working with a single vendor versus a cloud architect or an enterprise architect who will be working with 1,000 vendors, you can be a little more detail-oriented on that single vendor. So understand that. So the first thing we do as cloud architects, and it's the main part of our job, is we have business and technical discussions with the client. We need to learn about the client's business goals, the client's business pain points, the way the business operates, the way they want it to operate in the future, which is called the business architecture. And we need to learn about that organization's technology needs, what they have and what they need in the future to get to those future business goals. So that's the first thing we need, is a lot of discussions back and forth. The next thing we do is create architecture teams. So an architecture is typically not designed by a single person. We will have to create an architecture team. So in the real world, it may take a team of 50 people 6 months to truly learn an organization's business needs and understand their current technology platforms. And that may include, for example, say 10,000 routes on the routing table, 100,000 IP addresses, 5,000 remote offices where people actually work, 500 enterprise applications, 25,000 servers, tens of thousands of containers and petabytes of data. So that's typically what an enterprise architect or a cloud architect like me would walk into. And we have to create a team for that, because no one person can know networking at the level we need to, and we'll know security at the level we need to, and the organization's big data at the level we need to, and AI capabilities at the level we need to, if it's only going to be one person. And we're not only going to need architects who are more businessy focused, but we're also going to need some engineers on the team who are better, more experts on working with these technologies to see if what we want to do sometimes is even feasible. So we will also need this architecture team that we create to respond to an RFI or an RFP or an RFQ. So, for example, when a customer wants something, they may send out a request for proposal, and it may have 300 pages of questions. And each question may take a 5-page response. A question could be like, how would you implement design a 99.999% available system on your platform? And that would obviously take a big response. And that could be one question. You may get hundreds of pages of questions, which is no big deal when you've got an architecture team. So you get the questions, you figure out who's the best expert to answer those questions, you send it out to your team, they send you responses, you put it together, you edit it, and then you send it off potentially even to a tech writer to optimize it, and then send it back to you, and then send to a proposals team, etc. So in many cases, you will need that architecture team to help you with that RFI, RFP, RFQ. Now, the next thing we do a lot as architects is we give presentations all the time. It'll be a presentation at a conference, a presentation to the customer, a presentation to the C-suite, potentially be part of a day's worth of executive briefing. So we give a lot of presentations as architects. So keep that in the back of your mind. Now, when we create an architecture to help our clients, it gets pretty expensive pretty fast. So the client's not going to want to have budget or pay for it unless we can show the impact of the solution on the organization's business financially. So often as cloud architects and solutions architects, we're helping to build a business case and an ROI model to show what the architecture can do for the business. Now, as architects, we're going to have a lot of meetings. So we may have an architecture team of, say, 50 people. And we may have to work with those 50 people over 6 months, and we need to know who's doing what. We have to check the status of various things. We need to find what problems occur along the way. So we'll be leading and facilitating a lot of meetings. We will also have meetings with the clients and the client's technical team and the client's business team. We will also have meetings with various stakeholders. So we're going to be doing a lot of leading and facilitating meetings. Now, the next thing we will particularly do as cloud architects, but to some degree, even an AWS solutions architect or an Azure solutions architect will do this, and that is managing vendors. So in many cases, there will be hundreds, if not thousands, of vendors in an organization's technology solution. So if you're an enterprise architect or a cloud architect, you're getting involved in a lot more vendor management. Even if you're a solutions architect working for a cloud provider, you'll still have to work with other companies and other technology platforms. So there's lots of vendor management in any form of an architectural role, whether you work pre-sales or whether you're post-sales. Now, another thing we do a lot of as architects, as part of our solutions architect job description or cloud architect job description, is meet with stakeholders. So stakeholders are anyone that has a stake in the business and its outcome. And when we architects work with an organization that has 100,000 people and say 10 different business divisions, different business units, in many cases we have 10 different basically CEOs of various business divisions, and all their businesses may operate a little differently. So when we have any solutions, each one of our solutions can impact each one of those differently. So we will have to spend a lot of time with stakeholders, get their needs, make sure any solution we design is going to be good for their business, get them to agree with it, get their willingness and ability to buy in and say, yes, I will adopt this architecture and I will make sure my staff uses it, that kind of thing. So a lot of stakeholder management. If the stakeholders are not engaged, guess what? The architecture project will fail. Now, the next thing we do a lot of is proof of concept testing, but we lead it, we don't do it. So typically speaking, if I get a proof of concept test, I'll bring a few engineers with me and they will build it. I will be the in between those wonderful engineers that are building it and the client and the client's needs. If those engineers need some help, I will be able to, because I am not touching the technology call, and get whatever resources or escalate whatever I need to do in my company to get them help. In the meantime, I'm a good face to the client and I'm always customer facing with the client. So we do a lot of leading of proof of concept testing. Now, we also do a lot of client meetings. So, obviously, I talked about meeting with them to get information from them and back and forth and sales meetings, etc. But it's also about relationship development. So, a lot of times we will visit a client site. We'll have a face-to-face meeting with them, a face-to-face presentation. You may also be taking your clients out for dinner and drinks, and in many cases, it's good for you to do so to actually build a relationship with that client. They'll be more likely to give you information that you need because they help you, and with the information you gain, hopefully you can offer them a solution that's going to be good for their business and help them in some way. So there's that. You also need to make an impact with your clients, and in many cases, your solutions can run up to hundreds of millions of dollars. And people don't want to spend that kind of money without knowing you and having a relationship with you and feeling like you're truly in your corner and you really being there for them. So lots of client meetings like that as well. Another thing we do a lot of as architects where we spend our time is assessing the client's capabilities, both business and technology. So, for example, can the client even adopt the tech at once? So maybe a client has some big AI goals, right? But they don't have any quality data right now. So it may not be able to adopt the AI. There may be some intermediary steps that need to occur along the way, for example, to get that client to its goals. Or a client has the need for critical availability and a network that can self-heal itself. And there's a technology that client can use that can get them down to 40 milliseconds for the network to heal after a cable cut or a router failure, which is incredible. But perhaps maybe there's 15,000 people in the world that know that technology and can make it work, and none of them work for the company. So the company can't do it anyway, even though it would be a perfect architecture. So the organization's readiness is key, and we do a lot of assessment of that. We also create a lot of governance structures for an organization. For example, who will lead the implementation, who will basically teach the employees how to use it, the new applications, who will market the applications to the employees to get them to want to use it, those types of things. When a change needs to be made in the system, when it can occur, what's the process to make that. We also do a lot of technology roadmaps. And we look at the organization's business objectives and see where they want to go each year. And we build a roadmap of technology that'll get them there. We may also develop and enforce architecture standards and best practices. So we can say that for every customer-facing demilitarized zone for something that needs publicly accessible on the internet, it needs to be secure this way. So that could be an architecture standard we would work with. As architects, we also ensure compliance with industry regulations and industry standards. We get involved in a lot of strategic planning sessions. Whether we're working for a vendor like AWS or Azure or Cisco or IBM and it's strategic sales planning sessions, or whether it's strategic planning sessions with that organization and their executives and where they want to go, and then we need to be able to plan with them the technology that's needed to get there. We plan cloud migrations. And we do a whole lot of sales. I mean, we're not sales reps per se, but either you work as a solutions architect, and that's typically pre-sales, like you work for a cloud provider and you design, present, and sell their solutions. Or you work for an end customer and you design an architecture and you still have to go to that senior management, that C-suite, to show them that, okay, you're going to spend this $10 million a year on this and it's going to do this for your business. So a lot of that. We also create business continuity and disaster recovery plans, and we create statement of work. So now you know the actual cloud architect job description, that AWS solutions architect job description. Now, what are the skills that you need to be able to fulfill this solutions architect job description? Because unfortunately, as we've covered, they're not taught in that certification, even though that certifications and the certifications out there can be very beneficial for us. So the skills we need are things called CXO relevancy, which is the ability to relate to the executive team and speak to them in their terms. We need a lot of business knowledge or business acumen, because if every solution we're designing is to impact our client's business performance, We have to know about business because we need to know business strategy. Leadership skills are going to be absolutely critical because we're going to be leading teams of engineers and architects. I talked about managing stakeholders, so we'll need good, strong stakeholder management skills. Now, we're constantly selling, whether it's to senior management or selling to an end customer, so we will need good, strong scale skills. We will need really great communication skills because of all this customer relationship development and all these meetings and that we'll be working with in presentations. So good, strong presentation skills. And of course, the ability to manage vendors, negotiate with clients and key stakeholders, and the ability to be relevant and project yourself as an executive to executive. Now, I had mentioned we're not hands-on, but I don't want you to think there's no tech involved in our jobs. We need network design skills like selecting the right wide area network technology or planning the IP addressing scheme or the routing or planning or knowledge of routing protocols like BGP. We need compute design skills when we can plan servers and server virtualization and container orchestration and function as a service type computing. Knowledge of storage area networks and knowledge of block storage, object storage, file storage. Knowledge of security and how to design for security. Big data design skills and AI design skills, and of course cloud design skills, which in most cases are hybrid multi-cloud architectures. So now you know what is the exact job description, and now you know what we do, and I hope these skills make sense for you. So now go out there and build your cloud architect career. If you're interested in becoming a cloud architect or a solutions architect or an enterprise architect or a security architect, we've got a free webinar that we run almost every week that can help you get to your goals. Please join us on one of our free webinars. You can see those listed in the description of this video. We also have free ebooks that will cover the cloud architect career, the enterprise architect career, the AI architect career, and they're completely free. They'll cover everything you need to know to build that great architecture career. So download them, they're completely free. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. Please subscribe to our channel and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to assist you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I look forward to seeing you in a new video. Take care.